Malaysia will be declared COVID-19 free if zero cases for 28 consecutive days. Mosque Surah committees to decide capacity of congregation members.
Hello, good afternoon. I'm in Carlos and welcome to news or updates at noon. Well, Malaysia will only be declared free of COVID-19 if no new positive cases are recorded for 28 consecutive days. Well, Health Director General Dato Dr. Nur Hisham Abdullah said it was in line with the mechanism used to monitor a cluster, which was the length of two cycles of incubation in the virus infection.
Kalau kita lihat sekarang ni, kalau kita tamatkan satu kluster, kita memakan masa tempoh 28 hari pemantauan, iaitu dua kitaran inkubasi. Jadi kalau kita menggunakan pakai pemantauan dan pengawasan untuk tempoh 28 hari, bermaksud kalau kita tak ada kes sifar untuk tempoh 28 hari, kita akan isytiharkan bebas daripada COVID-19. Iaitulah yang kita guna pakai sebagai tanda aras kita lah.
He said this at the daily media briefing on COVID-19's development in Putrajaya yesterday. According to international media reports, New Zealand on Wednesday declared the country free of COVID-19 after 17 days of no new cases in the country. However, the country still closes its doors to foreign tourists.
Well, more economic sectors will be allowed to open throughout the Recovery Movement Control Order, or RMCO, period, as long as the number of daily COVID-19 cases are under control. Dr. Nur Hisham Abdullah yesterday said, for instance, the ministry is currently working on the standard operating procedures, or SOPs, for reflexology and massage activities at health and beauty establishments, which is currently still prohibited under the RMCO.
During this recovery period, which began 10th June and is scheduled to end on 31st August, Dato Dr. Nur Hisham said the ministry is encouraging all sectors to open in stages.
Jadi kita telah pun membuka kedai gunting rambut, salon dan sebagainya. Tetapi sekarang ni kita juga lihat kepada sektor-sektor yang lain dan yang pasti kalau kita sampai penghujung PKPP ini, kita dah kalau boleh mula buka semua sektor dan kita kena pastikan jumlah kes harian tak meningkat. Jadi kalau kita boleh kekalkan dua angka ataupun satu angka dan kalau kita boleh turunkan lagi jumlah kes dan kita boleh buka lebih banyak, jadi kita kena seimbangkan kedua-dua tu.
Newly appointed Senator Raz Adiba Razzi has forwarded a request for the reopening of reflexology services mainly run by the disabled community. Dr. Nur Hisham said the Health Ministry was streamlining the SOPs and to present it to the National Security Council, or MKN, next week. Well, he said the SOPs on the matter needed to be discussed with all parties on methods that could be adopted to ensure that no transmission to occur.
Well, morning markets, urban markets, night markets and bazaars in Selangor will be allowed to reopen in stages beginning 15th June. Now, Menteri Besar Dato' Sri Amiruddin Jari said the National Security Council's standard operating procedures, or SOPs, would be used as a reference in the implementation and enforcement in the operation of all types of market and coordinated by local authorities who would adjust the SOPs based on the areas concerned. Well, previously, morning and night markets in Selangor were not allowed to operate before standard operating procedures, or SOPs, are drawn up by the state government and local councils. Well, in a statement yesterday, Dato' Sri Amiruddin said the state government will not hesitate to close the premises or areas deemed risky in the event any party fails to comply with the SOP fully. Well, traders at morning and night markets were allowed to operate nationwide when the Recovery Movement Control Order, or RMCO, came into force. Well, he said the state government also reminded all parties to scan the QR code with the Selangka system before entering any premises, besides wearing face masks and maintaining personal hygiene by regularly washing their hands. Well, the expansion of congregational capacity for mosques, Friday Surau and selected Surau in green zones in the federal territories of Kuala Lumpur, Putrajaya and Labuan will be determined by the mosques, Friday Surau and selected Surau committees. The Federal Territories Islamic Religious Department for Jawi Director Muhammad Ajib Ismail stressed that the expansion of the capacity of the congregation was, however, subject to a third of the capacity of the mosque, Friday Surau and selected Surau's main prayer hall and involving worshippers from among Malaysians. Well, I said the ruling is also subject to the guidelines set in accordance with the advice of the Ministry of Health, the MOH, the National Security Council, MKN. In a statement yesterday, Muhammad Ajib said Jawi would also like to remind that all relevant guidelines and standard operating procedures or SOPs must be complied with during the Recovery Movement Control Order, RMCO. Well, he also hoped that Muslims could take advantage of this opportunity by boosting their religious practices and praying for the COVID-19 transmission in the country to end soon. Well, yesterday, Minister and the Prime Minister's Department, Dato' Sri Dr. Zulkifli Muhammad Al-Bakri, announced that all mosques in the green zone in the federal territories would be open gradually for Friday and congregational prayers, with an increase of one-third of the total capacity limit for the main prayer hall starting today. Well, he said the matter was submitted to and approved by the Yang di-Pertuan Agong Al-Sultan Abdullah Riayatuddin Al-Mustafa Billah Shah. Well, a retiree was fined 6,000 ringgit by the Magistrates Court in Port Dickson for drunk driving, making him the second person to be punished for this offence within a week at this resort town. Well, Syed Mahmud Syed Nazimuddin, 71, from Bandar Spring Hill, pleaded guilty after the charge was read to him before Magistrate Siti Huzaifa Abdul Talib. Now, he was charged under Section 45A, Subsection 1 of the Road Transport Act 1987, which provides a fine of between 1,000 ringgit and 6,000 ringgit or jail not exceeding 12 months. Siti Huzaifa ordered the accused to serve 6 months in jail if he failed to pay the fine. Well, Syed Mahmud paid the fine. The accused was driving along Jalan Kampung Baru Sirusa when he was stopped by a police team conducting Ops Mabuk at around 11:05 p.m. last Saturday. The breathalyzer test was conducted and his blood alcohol content reading showed a 211 milligram per 100 milliliter reading of alcohol in his blood at the roadblock. Now, the legal blood alcohol content measurement is 80 milligrams per 100 milliliters. And last Friday, M. Subramaniam, a 45-year-old unemployed man from Taman PD Utama, was also fined 6,000 ringgit by the same court as a breathalyzer test showed that he had a blood alcohol content reading of 219 milligrams per 100 milliliter. Well, the Kuala Lumpur High Court yesterday set 10th July 4 decision on six accused in the murder of Deputy Public Prosecutor Dato' Anthony Kevin Marais, whose body was found in a barrel filled with concrete 5 years ago. Now, Judge Dato' Azman Abdullah set the date after the submissions by both parties at the end of the defense case. Now, the trial began on 6 April 2016 with 84 witnesses, including 14 from the defense, called to testify. Well, lawyer Dato' N. Sivanandan, representing pathologist Colonel Dr. R. Kunasigaran, 57, who is the first accused in his submission among others, said that the evidence presented by the prosecution was insufficient to convict his client with a murder charge and that the motive raised by the prosecution did not prove his client was guilty. Meanwhile, lawyer Dato' Shilan Arjunan, who represented the other five accused, that's R. Dineshwaran, A.K. Tinesh Kumar, M. Vishwanath, S. Nimalan and S. Ravi Chandran, among other things, raised the question of the existence of an unknown DNA derived from a wire used to tie a sack in which Marais's body was found. Deputy Public Prosecutor Saiful Idris Zainuddin, who is prosecuting in the case with Deputy Public Prosecutor Wan Shaharuddin Wan Ladin, said although Kunasigaran was not seen anywhere in the murder case, the witness's testimony showed the accused had motives in the killing. On the existence of the DNA of an unknown person, Wan Shaharuddin argued that the court cannot ignore other evidence that had been adduced in court. Now, all the accused are charged with murdering Marais between 7 a.m. and 8 p.m. on 4th September 2015. Now, they were charged under Section 302 of the Penal Code, read together with Section 34 of the same law, and face the mandatory death sentence if convicted. Coming into Malaysia this year is unlikely to reach the 207.9 billion recorded last year. Now, at the launch of the Memorandum of Understanding, or MOU, between Standard Chartered Bank Malaysia Berhad and the Malaysian Investment Development Authority, or MIDA, well, its MIDA Chief Executive Officer, Dato' Azman Mahmud, said that while investment level is anticipated to be lower this year, it will grow as the economy recovers. Well, however, he said as the economy recovers and the Bejana package being the driver for the economy to return to normal implemented, investment numbers are expected to go back up to historical levels. Now, Dato' Azman also announced that it has a pipeline of investment projects worth 37.8 billion ringgit, with many foreign electrical and electronic firms looking to relocate their businesses to Malaysia as part of production diversification efforts. He added that there are many countries that are now looking for investments, and as such, Malaysia has to take up all opportunities available to get more investments. Well, Malaysia received 31.7 billion ringgit in foreign direct investments, or FDI, last year, and an increase of 3.1% from 30.7 billion ringgit in 2018. Well, according to the Department of Statistics Malaysia, or DOSM, at the same time, Malaysia's direct investment abroad, or DIA, also posted a healthy growth of 26.5% to 26.1 billion ringgit in 2019.
Chief Statistician Dato' Sri Dr. Muhammad Uzair Mahidin said the encouraging performances of both FDI and DIA show the favorable economic situation in the country that has attracted foreign companies to continue investing, and similarly for local companies to expand and diversify their activities abroad. However, he cautioned that the COVID-19 outbreak would create a reduced FDI growth for the year.
Dalam situasi pandemik COVID-19 yang belum pernah terjadi sebelum ini dan telah menyebabkan ketidakketentuan ekonomi global, FDI dijangka berada dalam prestasi yang perlahan pada tahun 2020. Namun begitu, industri seperti kesihatan, pharmaceutical, perubatan dan aktiviti di atas talian seperti e-dagang dilihat berpeluang untuk memperluaskan perniagaan mereka. Oleh itu, syarikat tempatan harus memanfaatkan senario ini dengan memperluaskan dan meningkatkan aktiviti pengeluaran mereka bagi merangsang ekonomi negara.
In a virtual briefing yesterday, he said major contributors by country for FDI flows in 2019 were Japan, Hong Kong and the Netherlands. The high FDI was mainly due to injection of equity from Japan to Malaysia in health activities, while the foreign inflows were mainly channeled into the services sectors, particularly in health, real estate and financial activities. Dato' Sri Dr. Muhammad Uzair said Brazil became the top country for DIA, particularly investments in the oil and gas industry.
Well, Top Glove Corporation Berhad expects to see another record high financial performance for the fourth quarter ending August 31st, 2020, or Q4 2020, due to the continuous global demand for rubber gloves amidst the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic. Now, Executive Chairman Tan Sri Lee Wee Chai said the average selling price, or ASP, is expected to increase by about 30% in Q4 2020, which would contribute to the company's performance in the upcoming quarter. Well, he said in Q3 2020, ended 31st May 2020, the company's sales order rose by 180% and the ASP also increased by 30%, which resulted in the company's net profit surging to an all-time high of 347.90 million ringgit versus 74.67 million ringgit in the same period last year. Well, in a virtual briefing during Top Glove's Q3 2020 results yesterday, Tan Sri Lim said based on the business logic, the profit can be doubled in Q4 2020 and sales revenue would be more than 30%. In a filing with Bursa Malaysia, Top Glove said its net profit skyrocketed by 365.92% to an all-time high of 347.90 ringgit million ringgit for Q3 2020 versus 74.67 million ringgit in the same period last year, with revenue jumping 42% to 1.69 billion ringgit from 1.19 billion ringgit previously. It attributed the extraordinary performance to unparalleled growth in sales volume on the back of the COVID-19 pandemic. Now, following the meteoric rise in its monthly sales order, the world's largest glove manufacturer said its lead time had increased from 40 days to around 400 days, whereby orders placed now would only be delivered over a year later. Meanwhile, Managing Director Dato Lee Kim Miao expected further demand for rubber gloves to come from the United States, Mexico, Brazil, and other Latin American countries in Q4 2020. And after seeing tremendous buying interest from countries like China, Japan, South Korea, Singapore, and Taiwan since January 2020. Well, that's it from us this afternoon. In our top story, Malaysia will be declared COVID-19 free if zero cases recorded for 28 consecutive days. Well, News On 2 comes on at 7 this evening. I'm Amin Carlos. Do take care. Thanks for watching.